All right, we are going to begin. And those who are still shopping, that's great. Continue to do so. You can listen and stand, and there will be people coming in the next little while. I'm glad we started at 9:30. So welcome to those who are in this room and all those that are emergent. Welcome to the 2015 Wool Symposium. And welcome to Point Reyes. This is a wonderful place. We keep selling out our tickets, and we keep committing to being here because it's such a vibrant and energizing space for us that we keep kind of confining the event. So every year, if you feel a little more crowded, I apologize, but it's the trade-off for getting to be in this this beautiful land. And so I wanted to start, I'm going to introduce the day's events, and then I'm going to pass it off to our wonderful group of ranchers, farmers, and Resource Conservation District executive directors, and others, designers, who will be sharing with you this, what this system is, what this fiber system is, a regional fiber system. So just for the day's events, if you do see these on some of the doors, and they're also in your program, I would love to make sure that everyone has access to all the demonstrations, the sheep shearing, the natural dyes, everything that's happening. Make sure you take a look and get oriented with that which you want to learn. This is a learning community. Many of you are here because it's about interacting with the land through the people who manage the land, and it's about maybe touching base with a new skill that you want to perhaps bring into your own life through felting, through natural dyeing, through sheep shearing, through becoming a world-class sheep grader. There's all these ways to interact with the fiber system, and we are trying to expose that here through these demonstrations. All right. So today's events on your program, you all know where the restrooms are, you all know basically the Dance Palace layout. And I'm going to just start by a big thanks to this community. This is last year's symposium, and this is Hazel Flett, who's behind you all from Bodega Pastures. And she's caught in a candid moment where she's both, yes, she's in a part of a marketplace, but I would say it's the heart of what a marketplace is. It's about sharing your raw material, not just because you are selling it for an exchange of money. What you do is you're sharing information. And so many of the people here today had a past life as environmental educators. So many of us actually were on the landscape as teachers, working maybe in the mainstream system, and now we've gotten back out on the land, we've become educators in a different way. And so this to me is the heart of what we're trying to do. It's about an exchange of information, eye to eye. Who are the land managers? Who is the recipient? What's the connection? And how do we pass that to the next generation? And in terms of the work here, these people that you see around you are creatively approaching the Wool Symposium. We have seen in the first year, there was a beautiful interaction between Christine Vejar and Sally Fox at a panel where I think Christine said something like, well, I'd really like to use local wool. And then there was this panel of farmers saying, well, we grow wool and we're local. And I just remember this moment where it was like, oh, okay. There was no local wool in the yarn stores when this project started in 2011. I mean, maybe you'd see someone at the farm, like Mimi Luberman at the farmer's market promoting, and there's probably other of you with a history of knowing how it got into the marketplace. But the retail marketplace was so, it just wasn't there. And I saw Christine and a Verb for Keeping Warm just jump forward, and they worked with a farmer to produce the first retailed yarn, which we call Pioneer. Such a fitting name on so many levels. And then there was the ongoing work of someone like Marley DeSwart, who has Black Mountain Weavers here in town, who's been ongoing relating to the farmers, and she's here every year, bringing the new iteration of her creativity through as a knitter, as a designer, working with local materials. And then what we saw this year, which I thought was so amazing, if any of you miss seeing Julie Rosenfeld here, this amazing high-quality alpaca, I don't think she's here because she sold her whole clip to Shelly from the Knitterly, the yarn store in Petaluma. So actually, all of that alpaca went into a new yarn line called Radius this year. So, and these are all connections that are happening in this room and in that space. All these new relationships are forming where the land base is now getting into the retail space. And again, it's still, we're keeping that continuity of land-based connections. So if you want Radius, you can go to the Knitterly in Petaluma, and you can go to Pioneer, get Pioneer from a verb for keeping warm. So again, these are the collaborators, and these are just images from our last year's symposium and years prior. So these are the kind of cultural continuity that we're building here. But then the other piece is the careful land management. And this is Robin's farm up in Solano County. And these are her Jacob sheep, who are here today if you'd like to go say hello in person. They're in the back. And these sheep are, they're on pasture. They're on an irrigated pasture, I believe on 10 acres. Is that right, Robin? 10 acres. 7 to 10, okay. And you can talk to her more about how she manages this landscape. And so what is fascinating to me, though, is as we, and you'll hear more about this, as we emerge into a new reality where we're in our third, fourth year of severe drought that hasn't been chronicled in our knowledge other than through tree rings in Mono Lake and through bay core samples in the San Francisco Bay, we know we might have had a drought like this 1,000 years ago when there were a tenth of the human population here. So we know that the land is very much under a certain form of duress based on how many of us are now in California and we're experiencing such a severe lack of water. So the land management has become all the more refined in these years of drought and all the more intense, and also the stakes have risen. So in the face of the stakes rising, Fibershed's been working with who you'll meet, resource conservation districts and the Marin Carbon Project and the Carbon Cycle Institute, to bring what is this emergent reality of carbon farming, which you heard about in prior symposiums. The idea that we're going to increase the amount of carbon capture on our landscapes, which means more trees, more willow, more grass. And through doing that, by increasing carbon capture on these landscapes, we're increasing soil organic matter. Soil organic matter, also known as SOM, is a very vital piece of this story. And as we increase soil organic matter, we increase the soil's ability to hold water. So the soil becomes our reservoir in times of drought. But our soil must increase its holding capacity through the increase of carbon, which is happening through these carbon farm plans. And this year, Robin Lind, Kelly Dunage, Marnie Jackson, Mary Pettis-Sarley, I can't think, there's Leslie Adkins, I believe it was Amy Chestnut and Joe Posey, others in this community knew about carbon farming early on and made calls to their resource conservation districts and said, we want to be the first carbon farm landscapes. So your Fibershed community has been so interactive in this idea around the intersection of the emergent land management and how they're going to do it on their land. And the importance of that is that while we know that these practices, that this is what carbon farming is, these practices are not only a resiliency strategy against climate change, they ameliorate the crisis in themselves. How do they do that? We're removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere when we increase carbon capture on the landscape, because all of these plants are constructing themselves out of atmospheric carbon, and they become carbohydrates. And that's what feeds the sheep, and that's what feeds the other ungulates, is a carbohydrate, which was once atmospheric carbon. So all of this is a way of enhancing carbon capture. By doing this, again, you're enhancing your own productivity, your own water holding capacity in your soil, but you're also ameliorating the very thing that's the problem, which is 405 parts per million of atmospheric carbon now concentrated in the Earth's atmosphere. So we've looked at this climate beneficial idea. How do all these land managers who are interested in having carbon farm plans, how do we help tell that story of amelioration, resilience, community organizing. We're going to do it through an early stage regional certification, and this is called Climate Beneficial Wool. And we've been promoting this idea to many, and it's been taken on by some really wonderful organizations already, including the parent company of the North Face that is interested in supporting some of the larger producers in California to help them actually become climate beneficial by helping them engage and helping pay for some of these first tier practices on their land. So the climate beneficial certification is something that we want to be able to say you have once you start implementing your carbon farm plan. But again, this is the snapshot now for you all. Where are we with carbon farming and where are we with climate beneficial wool? This is actually the first practice that we've been so excited about, which is compost applications on rangelands. We've talked about it a lot. It can sequester approximately 1 ton per hectare per year for a minimum of 30 to 40 years. The computer models show we could, with 1/2 inch layer of compost, we could sequester that much carbon for up to 100 years. It increases the water holding capacity by 26,000 liters per hectare, and it increases productivity 50 to 70%. So it's an economic benefit while it's also creating slow release fertilization for your rangeland and pasture, which increases the ability for the plants to perform longer into the season. They perform longer in the season, that's more forage, but that's also more time that they're capturing carbon from the atmosphere. And then it's an ascending spiral. So compost is an exciting thing that came out of, an analysis of this came out of the Marine Carbon Project. Hi. And so this first practice is now, this is in May of 2015. We started this conversation, and I believe this compost pile started happening in Lonnie, what year, what month?
July.
So Lonnie Estelle is one of the first, truly, I think she will be our first certified climate beneficial wool producer. She's from the High Desert Fiber Shed. She's come down. She has her first line of yarn available now. This is the first new, this is the debut, really. And she's committed to this process of using feedstocks on her ranch, manures that are already present, and using spent hay and juniper chips from the Cal Fire that's been, you know, chopping juniper for fire mitigation. These carbon and nitrogen-rich feedstocks are becoming a compost pile on her ranch, which will then be used, actually, I believe on the alfalfa pivot behind, we're going to do an application and offset some of the use of synthetic fertilization, but also, you know, increase the microbial activity in the soil by applying this compost, because compost, again, it actually enhances microbial activities through its application. So it's soil health, it's carbon sequestration, it's water holding capacity, and it's making use of materials already on the ranch. So here's Lonnie's pile, and we were so excited to see this happening. I mean, this is, it looks, again, it's so simple, but this is how, it's these simple technologies put into action at scale that are going to solve these problems. And it's this producer community that's taking it on at the earliest, earliest stages of its inception. Now, some of you know in our community, Lauren Poncha, he actually had the benefit of receiving a SIG grant and becoming one of the first demonstration sites. And Lonnie came out and met with Lauren, and there was an organized excitement around the idea of compost, because Lauren Poncha raises sheep and cows out in Tamales, and he had already had the benefit of a grant to help him lay compost out on his landscape. He saw the impacts of the compost application, and he's now making his own compost, and he's starting to apply it himself, and he has the first completed carbon farm plan because he was part of the Marine Carbon Project demo sites. So his wool is mattress grade, and we actually found a buyer. So Lonnie's wool was, just to let you know, Lonnie's wool was bought by the parent company of the North Face, who wants to start a climate beneficial wool program. It'll be the first in the world. And they're willing to pay more for the wool, which we love, right? Okay. So So then they're also, in Lauren's case, a boutique hotel owner bought his wool and is putting it in mattresses and spearheading a climate beneficial mattress program for hotels in California. And so his practice was, okay, we've got compost already. What's the second practice on his carbon farm plan? These are carbon farm plans have lots of different practices. You saw the list, potentially. This happened this week. This is the second practice implemented. It's a critical planting area known as a riparian forest buffer. Toyon, coffeeberry, a lot of the plants you see here displayed were put into this area where the land had gullied, and water was running off of his landscape so quickly that the surrounding soils were not getting access to that water. So this way of slow spread, sink the water is going to happen through the root systems of these species. Some of them are known as chaparral species, but they were put in. You can see they're cow-proof plants. They've got their, and sheep-proof. And this happened again. These are the children who put them in. These are fourth graders restoring the land. That's not a fourth grader on the right, but on the left. Those are fourth graders from the Straw program. Lorette Rogers is now part of Point Blue, and Point Blue was contracted by the Marin RCD to do this work. So this is the Marin Carbon Project demonstration sites taking off. What an exciting thing to see more carbon capture. And we know exactly how much carbon is expected to be sequestered by implementing this practice in its initial year and in 20 years as these plants mature. By using something called the Comet Farm Planning Tool, we know exactly what's happening. And it's a conservative computer model. So there's a lot more carbon sequestered than the model even says, but we're happy. And then I just wanted to bring into light the silvopasture. One of the practices that I feel like our landscape could start ingratiating ourselves into more is putting oaks back on the land. Yeah, returning the oak savanna to California. And I asked our rangeland ecologist, what is going on with silvopasture? And he said, well, California. These beautiful oak woodlands were dotted with valley oaks and coast live oaks, and the ungulates, the wild ungulates, used to graze in between, and they had shade. And there was higher productivity around some of these areas because the trees were sequestering more water there. There was more water holding capacity. In the 1800s, we cut the oaks down for firewood, and we drained our meadows of water. We were a water-rich state when the first peoples came from Europe, from Spanish colonization. All of these colonial era practices were based on a California that was watered and well watered. That is not the case anymore. So what do we do to put back the things that helped increase the water holding capacity? Put the trees back in the rangeland. So the silvopasture, and I have numbers, in the carbon farm plan that we have, we're hoping to put around 53 acres into silvopasture on one of our demonstration ranches, and that would allow for around 3,988 carbon dioxide in equivalence, it's called CO2e, to be sequestered over the lifespan of this silvopasture that we would like to be putting in. And that equates to driving your car 34 million miles. So if any of you had plans to drive your car 34 million miles, you could offset it by planting oaks in your neighbor's yard and yours and many others. It's an amazing amount of carbon from the silvopasture. And just one more piece around silvopasture. You can see here, we're at the Hopland Research Institute in Mendocino. What they said was that they have a 50-year longitudinal study. Why are the oaks not repopulating on their own? A lot of it has to do with herbivory, wild herbivory that's out of balance due to lack of predators, and our own livestock management practices. So the oaks haven't been coming back on their own. The only site in 50 years that the Hopland Research Institute said that the oaks are coming back is an area that's been fenced from deer, and it's been fenced from all grazing the whole 50 years. But you don't need to keep the ungulates off, you just need to protect the trees. So I asked the Hopland Research Institute, what's the best way to bring the oaks back? And they said, like the blue jays do, take your acorns, put 5 in the ground, and put a cage around them. And so, a bunch of homeschool children harvested Coast Live Oak acorns for you, and these are going to be at the main table, so I hope you go home with a handful of Coast Live Oak acorns. Put at least 5 in, and if you have grazers or any kind of ungulate activity, protect it with a fence. So here's a silvopasture. I don't know how much offsetting we could do with these acorns, but it's pretty strong potential. So this is where silvopastures used to be. This is where we could put them back in. Look how much of California could come back in terms of its oak woodland potential. It's a rich, rich landscape, and oak woodlands are one of the 25 most biologically diverse ecosystems on our planet. So just to remind ourselves why we're doing this, because at this point, climate change has gotten to the point where now fourth graders are suing governments. We've gotten to the point where children are suing the state of Washington, they're suing the Obama administration, and they're saying our right to life is threatened by your inaction. So if you read Zoe Foster, she's 12, she's the leader of that. Those are fourth graders sitting there, but Zoe Foster is one of the older children involved. And she says, kids understand the threats climate change will have in our future. I'm not going to sit by and watch my government do nothing. We don't have time to waste. I'm petitioning my government to take real action on climate, and I won't stop until it is made. So this is a legal lawsuit. This lawsuit was going on as of this week in Washington State. The children are asking Washington State to cap their emissions. They're suing the Department of Ecology. All right. So when your children start getting legal, you know you gotta do something. All right, and just another little moment of awareness. This is the reason we'll probably be swimming in this room in the next 20 to 45 years. This is the West Antarctic Ice Sheet. And in July, there was two studies. Potsdam Research Institute came out with a study that this ice sheet has the ability to raise global sea levels 10 feet. And it's going to hit a tipping point where it can no longer stop melting within the next 2 years if we don't cool the planet down. So that level of sea level rise means we're going to have our wool symposium in the Himalayas, which I'm not averse to. But seriously, this is going to be a lot of restructuring to civilization. So we have a lot of carbon we got to capture. It's a good thing. It's in the wrong place. It needs to be in the soil. So we know we can do this. This came out of, and I have the paper for if you want to refer to any of the peer-reviewed research, I have the document on the welcome table. This is a policy institute that took a bunch of different peer-reviewed data points and put it into one aggregate paper. We are over 400 ppm, that's parts per million. We need to get back to 350. We need to restore 50 parts per million or 106.25 gigatons of carbon into our soil. We know that all the carbon will fit in the soil because that is where it came from. We have brought 136 gigatons of carbon out of the soil by land clearing and agriculture since the beginning of the industrial age. But how quickly can we put that carbon back in? The Food and Agricultural Organization, that's the FAO of the UN, says there are 8.3 billion acres of grassland on the globe and 3.8 billion acres of cropland. As long as we don't concrete that stuff over, if everyone were willing to use carbon building practices on those acres annually, the grasslands at an average of 2.6 tons per acre could restore 21.6 gigatons, and the croplands at an average of 0.55 tons per acre could restore 2.1 gigatons. Those are annual rates. This gives us a total of 23.7 gigatons per year. So if we are interested in this restoration of 106.25 gigatons, we could do this in 5 years. But what's it going to take? Truly cooperation and willingness, like someone like Lonnie, who's like, yeah, I'll try it. That's great. Or Lauren Poncha, sure, sign me up. You need that kind of hopeful, engaged attitude that you so often get from land managers. They're hopeful people. They tend to be hopeful in the face of severe things because they're used to rolling with the punches. They don't have technology and a lot of things propping them up. They deal with grass, rain, and sun. And that kind of primacy to their lives, I think, makes them a hopeful group as a whole and a very I-can-do group. So in fact, the management of this kind of sequestration in the hands of people like who are in this room with their yarn, I'm extremely hopeful. Extremely. And so the UC Extension and our community recently said the loss or capture of carbon to the largely untapped sink capacity of agricultural land has direct consequences for production capacity, Rotan Lal, 2004. So this means mediating grower income and environmental degradation, biodiversity and resilience. Studies have shown that farms that utilize carbon-conscious agriculture techniques can be more profitable than those that maintain a more conventional agriculture management style. However, widespread integration of agricultural activities and practices that sequester carbon by farmers and ranchers is slow to adopt. We need to speed it up. In the absence of targeted education or formal guidelines, many farmers and ranchers lack the knowledge needed to consider agricultural strategies that foster carbon sequestration. So the whole point of what FiberShed's doing and what CCI is doing in the Marin Carbon Project is to help increase that education and the access and the funding to implement the practices at a rapid rate. We are also, at FiberShed, we are now going to, anyone who's in our producer community, if you want to test how much carbon is in your soil, we've partnered with UC Davis's Plant Sciences Lab, and for free, we can test the amount of carbon, total organic carbon, total carbon, and soil organic matter. We're going to move towards bulk density and water infiltration a little later, but we're going to start with this. It was a research protocol that came out of my collaboration with Dr. Marcia DeLange, who's part of the Union of Concerned Scientists. She and I went out on the landscape for several years, and we worked with farmers who were interested in knowing how much carbon they already had in their landscape. And so she and I kind of worked it, and we were like, oh, I think we could figure this out. This is not for peer-reviewed research, but this protocol is for you. How do I manage my land? How do I measure my impact? It's an initiatic phase to kind of get you started. If you're going to go put compost on the land, how much carbon did you start with? And then you'll want to know how much you ended up with after the compost application. Or I'm going to put a silvopasture in. I want to know how much carbon I have when I start. We call this baseline. This is for you to get baseline if you're interested, or you even want to manage an existing practice. It's free. We're offering this. The video and the how-to are now on the website as of last night. We are starting a tool lending library for you. All you need is this and some reused plastic bags and a Sharpie pen and the use of the post office. And then we can test how much carbon you have in your soil. And we want to do this for you, so you can start becoming more articulate managers of the land which you love. All right. And one of the people that Dr. DeLange and I worked with, who I'm going to introduce, it was Jamie and Robert of Chaos Sheep. And Jamie inspired us because she was like, oh, we're just going to go research our ecological impact. What are the ecosystem services to my business? I'm gonna go find out. So she and Marcia and Robert and I, we've spent a lot of time in the vineyards and we talked, and I just was so inspired because she's out on her own just navigating this as a land manager, and she's started some initial research, and I wanted you to hear directly from someone who's out on the land every day with their animals, a young person with the sheep.
Well, thank you. Can you guys hear me okay? Thank you, Rebecca. I'm constantly amazed with Rebecca because of the many projects she's got going on that are so beautifully connected and keep growing and keep bringing people together. So it's been really neat to work with her the last few years and keep bringing people, and things keep going. Like, sometimes things kind of stall out, but it seems to keep going. So thank you. So, Chaos Sheep Outfit, kind of a funny name, some of you might think. And sometimes when I'm out there, we joke, we need to change the name. This is way too much chaos. But when you put 5,000 sheep out on a 1,500 acres of vineyards, there's going to be a level of chaos. And there's so many things. You can have your building fence, they have enough feed in front of them, they've got water, they have nutrients, but there's a coyote that can come in, or domestic dogs, or bored teenagers that can burn your fence or cut your fence or steal batteries. There's always something going on. So we want to keep it a chaos because it's a organized chaos that is both frustrating and beautiful at the same time. So chaos sheep outfit. And about a year ago, we're out there and we're mowing the grass down, and I kept thinking, there's got to be more. We've got to be doing more out here. So I wrote a grant to Western SARE, S-A-R-E grant, to look at vines and ovines and what the benefits of target grazing are to both the sheep and the vineyard industry, because that's going to be our sustainability, right, for both our industry and their industry if we're doing more than just a tractor pass. Because when you're out there at 10 o'clock at night and then you're back out there at 4 in the morning and all, you know, stuff is happening, sometimes I think I'm just going to go buy a tractor and start mowing because that would be a lot easier. But there's got to be more. So we started looking into that. Chaos Sheep Outfit started 5 years ago. Rob and I moved to California from Oregon. We'd been there. Rob had been a grass seed farmer who had also raised sheep and a third generation a sheep man. And when the economy crashed in 2008, he had kind of, you know, his business had kind of grown to the point, but he didn't really have deep enough pockets to make it through the economy crash. So we sold the equipment and headed out on the road. I, at that point, had just finished school for science education. I had an outdoor education background, like you were talking about, and was kind of done with school at that point and kind of wanted an adventure. So we headed out. We traveled around. He's a sheep shearer as well, so he sheared and I pressed wool, and we got to travel to all sorts of different ranches and look at their different setups and sheep and what they fed their sheep year-round. And the thing about sheep people is you can work all day with the sheep and then you can stay up till 2 o'clock in the morning talking about sheep. I really didn't think you could talk. There's that much to be said about it, but there really is. So so we ended up landing in Clear Lake Oaks, California, and started working for a vineyard that had 100 sheep, and he wanted to build his flock to 1,000 and utilize them as a vineyard management tool. And so we kind of helped him do that, and at the same time kind of started building our own company. And we still kind of work with them in different ways, but Chaos Sheep Outfit kind of took off at that point. And because at that time, all we had was a truck and 50 sheep, we didn't really have enough to do much of anything. We kind of started piecing together the business. And because we were new to the area, you start building relationships. You don't want to step on, you know, people that are already in the area's toes. So you kind of, we ended up building this year of grazing where we travel quite a bit, which can be really hard, but it's also helped us get through the drought. We've kind of followed the feed, where the feed is and where people want sheep. So this is kind of an outline of the year. September, October, we bring in feeder lambs from the mountain states. We've got 2,000 this year. Last year we had 2,700. They get weaned from the mountain states and their moms, and then they head here, and we graze them in pear orchards. And we shear them at that time as well, because when they lay down on a rotten pear, they will get fly struck because it'll be all wet. So we shear them, which also helps with grazing in the vineyards, because if they have wool, it gets stuck on the irrigation drip line. So they come in, we get them going. October to December, so right now we're lambing. And 3 years ago, because of the drought, we took our ewes to alfalfa. And so that's where they are right now. We're halfway through, so that's nice. We've got 1,000 ewes to lamb, so it's been pretty busy. November to March is when we're in the vineyards with the feeder lambs, and then once the ewes lamb out and the lambs are strong enough, we take them back to the vineyards as pairs. And then April is when we start to, or when bud break happens, we start shipping the feeder lambs, and we ship our lambs as well. Feeder lambs are a little bit taller frame sheep, so it takes them a little bit longer to get ready to harvest. And our sheep are a little bit shorter frame, so they end up being ready to harvest about the same time. So we ship our lambs and the feeder lambs, and we're left with our ewes. And then we go into fire protection grazing with them. So we actually grazed Hidden Valley Homeowner Association up in Lake County, and how that helped with the fire protection around that quite a bit this last year. And then June to August, we do range grazing on the range and start breeding. That's when the ewes are breeding again. So that is kind of our year. Here are some pictures. Somebody once said to me, oh, you graze on other people's property, so that must mean you don't really care about it, or you don't have to worry about it as much. And I thought that was a really weird thing, because it's kind of the opposite. We run, you know, the 1,000 ewes are ours, but 2,000 of those lambs are somebody else's, and we're running for them, and then we're running on somebody else's property. And it's, I'm constantly amazed that people let us onto their property and let us have that many sheep on their property and then let us take care of that many sheep. It's kind of an amazing thing. And through the years, I mean, it's been 5 years, we've been to some of these places now, there's a, you know, you get kind of connected with the place. So it's kind of neat. That's the land managers or owners, and then the place as well. So it's just the opposite. But so here are some things that the sheep can do for the vineyard and for the other places that we graze as well. You know, they're competitive with the tractor. They do a good job. They mow it down. They eat the vegetation under the vines, which is great for organic and biodynamic vineyards that have a hard time keeping that down. There are mobile compost machines, so they're leaving manure everywhere. And the picture on the bottom right is a non-crop area where they graze star thistle. You can see where the fence line was. So you can see what they're doing. Like Joseph, the vineyard manager at Bonterra, says in the video you'll watch at the end, but you can see what they're doing. But sometimes we need to test what they're doing. When I drive through a couple weeks after the sheep have been there, the grass is kind of a different color green than the neighbor's grass. It's a beautiful color, but there's still that question, what's really going on? So that's why I kind of wrote the grant and started kind of asking those questions for both, the sustainability of our company, but also the sustainability or the sanity of myself. So I'm working with UC Davis Extension in Ukiah area. The viticulturist there, Glenn McGordy, and the livestock advisor, John Harper, and then their lab technician, Ryan Kiefer, has helped a lot. So we set up the trial, and it's on 10 acres of a vineyard and vineyard plot. And in a normal, our groups of sheep that we normally run are 300 to 500, but typically about 400. A group of feeder lamb comes in a truckload of about 450, so that's generally the group we run. So in that 10-acre plot, we divided it up into 8 sections and put grazed half of them and didn't graze half of them. So we used about 38 head of sheep per acre. About 225 sheep went into the research plot. And so this is the research plot at Bonterra Vineyards. And yeah, we've got the orange was grazed, and then the blue was not grazed. So, and each of those sections is about an acre big. So, the data that we took was to look at the forage yields, pre-grazing and then post-grazing, the soil bulk density pre and post, the soil fertility, vine yields and pruning weights, and then the fruit chemistry. So that's kind of what we were shooting for. Here's some pictures of the sheep in the trial. Again, these are feeder lambs, about 110, 115 pound feeder lambs. Here's some a little bit tricky. This was probably, well, this was the most work for me, was trying to get, you know, let's see, like 60 sheep in one spot, or, you know, 64 in one spot, and kind of a little bit tricky. So here's the grazing before and after. Now the following graphs, the viticulture, Scott McGordy, he and Ryan put these together and did all the analysis. They did a lot of work out there, and so it's, they did a good job. But so here's some information that they found. And the grant was only for a year, but they've agreed to go on another 2 years. And really, to see any difference, we'd have to do it 5 to 10 years, because like we all expected, there really wasn't much that's going to be shown in the first year. So we really need to do it longer. So if I can keep them happy with lamb, then I think that they'll keep working with me. But so as you can see, the forage, post-grazing, the sheep took about half of the forage from the area. And in a normal year, in a non-drought year, you'd expect to see like twice as much forage out there. So it's kind of different because of the drought. Soil bulk density. It looks a little different. So no pre-sheep, post-sheep, no sheep. But it's nothing, it's not considered statistically different. So that's what we found, bulk density. And then this is calculated from the bulk density. It's not a measured amount. But again, not statistically different. Phosphorus. So the way we did the soil samples, the gathered the soil samples pre and post, so post sheep and then post when they tilled. And so there's going to be some variability in the data because they till every other row, so that's going to affect the it's kind of some stuff that's confusing that's going on here is because kind of that. But the phosphorus we would expect to be tied up in the cover crop and then released like in the no sheep section. So we're not really sure what's going on in the sheep section because it was out there before. Potassium. So again, kind of different to start with than, so it's kind of and then the organic matter. So again, we only took the soil sample 6 inches down, and that was tilled. And so when that's tilled, that's going to affect the organic matter. So our conclusions are there was nothing really found about the year, about the grazing. But that's kind of what we expected to see, not any difference in the first year. And then we also learned quite a bit about where we did the testing. I think we're going to move the test site next year to a more uniform vineyard and soil selection, because it was kind of variable to begin with. So there's that bulk density, and the was not significantly changed. And it's a little tricky because it was in a drought year, so there's some variability there. So there's that. Yeah. Any questions? I don't deserve time. Do you do? Yeah. Oh, I have 5. Is that with the video? Should we do the? Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. So here's a video that we made, that was made to kind of highlight the research that we're doing and the work that we're doing with Bonterra.
One of the basic premises, I'd say, of biodynamic farming is that the fertility comes from within the farm, which then kind of feeds the farm.
Biodynamic, you're really looking at the whole farm rather than just your crop plant. It's looking at What cover crops do you have growing in between, and how do those affect the vine growth? When you mow those cover crops, realizing that you're removing habitat and therefore you're changing insect population dynamics, you're changing airflow.
We're doing that same theory that nature did before we showed up to kind of control craziness. And that's what chaos is, I guess.
The sheep will come in, they'll deposit fertility, they kind of add life to the soil, they add life to the farm itself.
It's an organic source for more biodiversity in the soil, more microorganisms that are going to decompose different materials.
It's a different paradigm. We're not like feeding the plant, right? We're feeding the soil. When you take care of your soil, the soil automatically takes care of what grows on top. When they leave, I feel like sad to some degree, because you don't hear them baying and the little lambs are looking for the mom. There's this whole thing happening here that I kind of take for granted until they leave. And then when they leave, it's just, there's this like silence.
My husband's a third generation sheep guy. I'm new to the whole sheep industry and kind of got thrown in and went for it. And it's been really exciting and it's kind of addictive.
She's got a natural resource and a science education background. I was born in a sheep barn, I guess.
We really wanted to pursue this and pursue this on a commercial level. How do we make this a viable company?
It's a lot more labor for us to have sheep in a vineyard. We've got to do some things differently, but I kind of look at it this way. If you're not willing to change or mold or do something different, then you're a dinosaur and you become extinct.
And more growers, you know, are calling...
Well, in the first year, everybody thought we were crazy. But then when we did it the second year, a lot of the other people started paying attention.
Yeah. We've seen it. If I look at my tractor hours for undervine weed control, they've consistently decreased. I think the other story to tell here is we're taking two businesses and we're putting them on the same footprint.
With the market as it is, consumers can drive how companies operate, how farmers farm, right? When the majority of consumers demand an organic product, practices shift.
The only way like a sustainable business is going to be is if we make money, and they've also got to make money with it.
We wrote a grant to see soil samples looking at carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus. We're going to look at pruning weights, leafhopper populations.
Infiltration of water, organic matter. Will there be a difference in the fruit, the amount of fruit, or the quality of the fruit?
Do we have better nitrogen components? Is it a better balanced fertility in the grapevine?
All these things that we see that are different, but sometimes we need to test to say it's different.
It's a very organic process, truly. 5,000 sheep in a 1,000-acre vineyard, that's an adventure.
Like anything in life, when you're 5 years old, you don't know everything, but you think you do. And then a year later, you think you know everything, but you know twice as much as the year before.
And down the road, we need to investigate farming systems like this, because as population increases, as our impact upon the environment increases, we need to come up with solutions like this and understand them.
I joke around about it with the friends I grew up with. If you'd asked me 10 years ago, you know, if I was going to move to California and do what I'm doing now, I'd bet you $1 million you're a liar. I'd be owing you $1 million right now.
Thank you. And now, we are... Please feel free to get Jamie and ask questions. And, you know, it takes around 3 years to understand differences in soil carbon. So that's why some of that research just needs more time to accumulate. And also, I think what's beautiful about her story, because I'm hearing it for the first time since the SARA grant was applied for, is this persistence. Science is something that requires refinement and dialing in. Sometimes you have to refine, you get this far in, and then you have to dial in farther, and then you dial in farther. It's like your barometer keeps, the gauges that you use to even create your barometer start shifting as well. So I think the takeaway for me listening to you is just my gratitude that you're willing to take it on, be a citizen scientist, and refine your game as you go. Thank you. Yeah.